The other day, I was watching a documentary that was explaining life on a particular plantation. And it came to a part that really caught my attention, really made me think. In showing the exterior of the plantation, they spoke about the picket fence that was surrounding the big house. The fence served as a barrier for both the house slaves and the field slaves. See, field slaves are not permitted to walk beyond this picket fence. If they had a message to deliver, they had to deliver it to the house slave, and vice versa. The house slave was not permitted to go beyond this fence to mingle with the field hand. They often had to prove that their loyalty lied with the slave master and his family. See, this fence has been a great divide among blacks for generations. But see, I can't just have a discussion about house Negroes and field Negroes. What I'd like to look at is how this divide even started and where it left us. Drop the footage.
Most American school children learn to recite this little phrase. In 1492, Columbus sailed the ocean blue. Columbus, in fact, was just one of many explorers sponsored by European monarchs in the 1400s who were all trying to find better, cheaper, faster route to Asia than the natives.
See, that's the version of colonization that you get in school, which is very patriotic. What I want to show you is the truth, minus the sugarcoating. When Europeans set out to colonize multiple countries all over the world, it was never a peaceful process. Whatever land they sought to take over or whatever slave labor they intended to create, they faced extreme opposition, as they should. The initial phase of colonization is always the most violent, which typically involves genocide or extermination of some format.
Contrived to send smallpox among those disaffected tribes of Indians. We must on this occasion use every stratagem in our power to reduce them.
These takeovers were by any means necessary. Military killing, spreading disease, burning villages, burning crops to induce starvation, any means in disrupting a way of life for pure economic gain. Even after this initial step, colonizers needed survivors to stop resisting. So step number two was implemented, which was the process of creating less resistance. This was a methodical tactic. The best way to get resistors to stop fighting for freedom, true liberation, was through the process of assimilation, forced assimilation.
Who can give me the names of the last four presidents? I would call on you, Ohayasa, but it must be by a white name. Have you chosen one from your book?
No.
James, your name is Toby. I want to hear you say it. Your name is Toby. You're going to learn to say your name. Let me hear you say it. What's your name?
Kunta. Kunta Kinte.
When the master gives you something, you take it.
Yaranigindi! Yaranigindi!
Come for the three girls, Maud!
No!
I'll bring my little black fellas camp.
Mine is mine, kid! Mine!
It's the law, Maud.
No!
I've got no say in it.
No, mine!
Oh, no, no, no!
Master Neville's orders are not free!
Remember that, you never
want to run! Listen, 1 inch and I'll lock your mother up!
Neville's their legal guardian.
Papers, Maud!
No, Dana! No!
You've got no say in it!
No!
Get in the car!
Nothing you can do!
Leave him!
See, forced assimilation removed some of the very basics of who we were. It removed our culture, our language, our name. Do you know how much history was lost just by the removal of your name? But what was once forced upon our ancestors eventually became a matter of survival. And thus, step number 3, economic assimilation. What do I mean? Again, the motive of colonization is pure economic benefit. And in colonizing a nation, stealing resources, and using free slave labor through the use of murder, deceit, thievery, and oppression creates an economic wealth system that is so disproportionate. Your whole race is forced to survive off of this. It won't be long before you naturally desire to be over here, where you can survive economically. Now let's go back to the Great Divide. See, anyone on this side of the fence almost always had economic advantages and was considered to be in a different class. Slowly, the goal changed from fighting for liberation to how can I be more like my oppressor? Yes, for survival, better economics, and ultimately, to please him. But let's see how this fence has divided us. It divided those who look more European compared to those of African descent. We've heard it, light skin versus dark skin. This fence also divided those that obtained special skills that the slave master deemed necessary to continue to build his empire, compared to those that did not have those skills. And those that had the skills had the opportunity towards their wealth system. This allows slaves to buy into their hierarchical class system, which sadly today still exists. See, it's often from this divide that you get the I have arrived speeches and reprimands on why you haven't. This fence also divided those who could manipulate the English language well or master the mannerisms. Still today, you have those that will shun you if you speak the master's language well. And vice versa, you have those that will shame and look down upon those that cannot create subject-verb agreements or conjugate a verb. And to those people I say, you do not want to see my outtakes. But don't get it twisted. Even with forced and economic assimilation, some field Negroes and house Negroes were still not divided because they were aware of one, that both of them were still slaves, and two, they were fully aware that on the other side of that fence that I didn't create was my sister or my brother. It was only when we lost sight of who we were to each other that division set in. And it only takes one generation to be broken, to lose sight. Then the division is self-contained.
And we had this aunt who could pass for a white man. And every time she would come to visit, she would give the light-skinned children a quarter. And she would give the dark-skinned children 10 cents. And when my grandmother found out that was happening, she would make us give the money back. She wouldn't allow us to take money from her at all.
See, this fence has served its purpose in our community. It has divided us among color lines and economic class. It's divided us based on levels of European education and knowledge of European mannerisms. It has divided our very thought of what's right and wrong. The great divide of this fence leads us to where we are as a people today, still fulfilling its purpose. And I won't sit here and blame those that have assimilated more, whether consciously or subconsciously, for the sake of economic advancement. I don't blame those that lash out and say, you ain't acting black. Because the truth be told, most of us don't know what acting black is, because that was stripped away from us generations ago. They associate black on the very premise of what oppressors told us black was, which was bad, ignorant, vile, or non-human. I won't even blame the millions of girls around the world that struggle with seeing that their dark skin and kinky hair is beautiful. And I won't even blame the European educated speeches that go out from your own race, shaming you on why you have not made it over to the land of plenty economically. Today is not about blame. Today is about understanding. If you understand science, you know that every action has a reaction. Every cause has an effect. And as a whole, the cause of assimilation has definitely had an effect. You want to see your race back balanced, thriving, economically and culturally, and truly liberated. It can only be done through unity. And unity and liberation starts here. This picket fence is a part of everyone's life. We all have it, and it's no shame in having it, but there's shame in knowing you have it and not trying to remove it. So this whole process starts with you.